So good evening and welcome you all to this third installment of our Gurubani lecture series. And I must appreciate all our students who have joined here because from tomorrow they have one sessional exam. So we were in doubt whether they will be joining with us or not. So I take this opportunity to welcome Dr. Soheb Ikram from Rabindra Bharati University, Calcutta, who has consented to deliver today's lecture. So on behalf of the Department of English, HPB Girls College, I welcome you. And I think we must not delay further. So I hand over the screen to you, Dr. Ikram. It's yours now.
Thank you very much. I would like to share the screen because I have a PPT and I hope the connection is installed because there's a lot of weather problem at my place because of the cyclone. So
Okay.
I need to share the screen. One second. Yes, is my screen being Yes, is the screen visible?
Yeah, perfectly visible.
Okay. Right. Good evening, everybody, and respected teachers, and my fellow senior, my colleague, Dr. Santolan. We go back a long way. He's been one of the most lovable seniors that I had. And today we are going to have a small talk on this particular topic, the rise of Indian English novel. Right now, before we start, we need to get a little bit of things clear that this particular arena of Indian English, Indian writing in English, is a very debatable one. Why? Because we don't have any fixed definition as to include writers. There isn't any fixed definition as to we would be including these writers when we talk about Indianness, because we at one end of the spectrum where we have writers like Mulk Raj Anand, we have Raja Rao, and we have R. K. Narayan. But at the same time, we also have writers like Salman Rushdie, we have writers like Ruth Praved Jhabwala, we have writers like Anand Kumar Swami. So the problem is many, many a times we confuse about this identity of Indianness. Now, we all know that Salman Rushdie does not currently hold any Indian passport, but nevertheless, he is a very integral part of this particular canon known as Indian writing in English, Indian novels. The same goes with Ruth Praved Jhabwala. We all know that she was born of Polish parents, but then she got married to an Indian, stayed a considerable amount of years in India. But still, she is not, by birth, by ethnicity, an Indian. But nevertheless, we still, keep her in the canon of Indian novels. The same goes with Anand Kumar Swami. Now, Anand Kumar Swami was born of Sri Lankan father, Tamilian father, and English mother. He never stayed in India per se. But nevertheless, we still include him in Indian writing in English. The same goes with Raja Rao. The big three, he was a part of the big three, Raja Rao, Mulk Raj Anand, and R.K. Narayan. But Raja Rao spent a lot of years, the most productive years of his life, he had spent in abroad. But he had written about India. But when we talk about V.S. Naipaul, it's the other way around. V.S. Naipaul is considered as an Indian, but his writings show much of an inclination towards the Caribbean than towards the Indian. So, nevertheless, the point which I'm trying to make here is the Indianness in Indian English novel is a very debatable arena. It's a very debatable topic. But we need to have an umbrella term and a kind of a you know, a broad definition that would include writers writing about India who have a flair, you know, a first-hand information about India. But the same logic doesn't apply with Rudyard Kipling. Why? Because Rudyard Kipling is not considered as an Indian writer, because he's more of a British writer. But nevertheless, these are the small areas which we need to, you know, keep ourselves aware of, so that tomorrow it becomes, you know, better for us if somebody questions us that how is Rushdie an Indian writer and not, you know, without having an Indian passport and Indian citizenship, but still we consider Rushdie as an Indian writer. Okay. Right. So this English was not an Indian language. We came in contact with English with a phenomena that is known as the Renaissance. Now, Renaissance had happened long time back. Remember, 16th century around. And it started with discoveries. It started Renaissance. In fact, it is said that Renaissance, it ushered into a new era, a kind of an era in which is known as the brave new world, the world full of possibilities. But at the same time, it has a darker side also. In fact, Renaissance is also considered as the darkest period for the natives. Now, what happened in Renaissance? We get to know about discoveries in Renaissance. What else do we know? We get to know new places. No, the desire to see new territory. There was a spirit of discovery that prevailed during the Renaissance. New places were discovered, and it all started from where? It started by our friend Christopher Columbus. When he discovered America long time back in around 1492, he set sail with three big ships, Pinta, Nina, and Santa Maria. And these three big ships, Nina, Pinta, and Santa Maria, he went and he found a new particular place called America. Now, this is called the freewheeling aspect of early colonial explorations. You simply go in a particular direction via the sea and you enlarge this particular world. New places were discovered, places like New Zealand. Abel Tasman discovered New Zealand. Captain Cook, he discovered Australia, Canada. These all new places were discovered. So so these discoveries always had an inert and an overt agenda. What was the agenda? The inert agenda was loot. The overt agenda would be, listen, I'm coming to your place. I'm going to give you culture, I'm going to give you religion, I'm going to give you language, I'm going to translate your books. Your books are wonderful, Upanishads and, you know, Persian books, wonderful books you all have. Let the entire world know about your books. So what I will do, I will translate your books into English and I would be giving it to the entire world to read. And what would in return I give you? I will give you the great philosophies of the West and I'll give this to your land. So this is what they did. They came as translators. They came as traders. They came to India. They said, let us trade. I give you cotton. You give me your spices. This is how we would be doing kind of a business. Now, this is what they had initially had in mind. So some places which were empty, they settled there. That is known as colony. That is known as settler colony. Places like Australia, South Africa, New Zealand. Okay, so these places, Canada, these places, they settled there. The white man settled there. And other places like Africa and India, they already, you know, kind of had a culture. They had people living there. So what they did there, they invaded it. They came as translators. They came as, you know, traders, that we come and we trade. Now, this can be seen in a wonderful poem by Rudyard Kipling, A Tale of Two Cities. He says, once 200 years ago, the trader came, meek and tame, very slow. Where his foot halted, he stayed, till mere trade. He did not go up beyond the places, just near to the coastal areas, the ship, for example, in Bengal, in and around Calcutta, Murshidabad, they stayed there, grew to empire. Then he sent his armies forth, south and north, till the country from Peshawar to Ceylon was his own. Wonderfully summarized how the British came in the garb of traders. Slowly and slowly, as the time went on, they captured the entire country and they became rulers. So this is the darker side of Renaissance. what the entire phenomena of colonialism is all about. Now, no, you see, India was a very, in fact, India is a very big land, very big land. And to govern a foreign country without knowledge of its language is a Herculean task to do. The Britishers got to know this pretty early. They understood that, kind of governing the entire country will be very difficult for us because people in Bengal speak a different language, people in Assam a different language, you go down south a different language, you go to Awadh a different language. There are so many languages that is to be learned. And then we cannot always rely upon translators because many a times we can also be fooled by the translators. So the Englishmen thought, let us make one language common for the entire country. And they chose English because they wanted English to be common from right from, you know, from the top of the country to right at the bottom of the country. Now, how did they do this? They decided to colonize the mind of the native. They wanted to colonize the mind. And how do they colonize the mind? By introducing their own culture, by introducing their own language, English language, their mode of education. And it was against this perspective that we have Macaulay's famous minutes of 1835. Lord Macaulay, his minutes of 1835 says that we need to, you know, create a class of brown sahibs, Indians who would be brown in color, but in taste, they would be English. Surrogate Englishmen. Okay, so we need to have Englishmen who would not be white, they would be brown Indians, but we would change their taste. We would make them Englishmen. We would give them an English language. We would introduce them to our culture, probably take a couple of them to the West, show what the world is all about, England is all about. And once they come back, they would be a different person altogether. They will owe their allegiance towards us. So the first roots of Western education, that is the first batch of Indians, were exposed to English literature as surrogate Englishmen. They were, you know, they got mesmerized by the entire English culture, the English canon, the English writers. Now, what did they read? They read Shakespeare for the first time. They read Milton. They read Romantics writer, Walter Scott. And they acquired a certain working mastery of the English language. Now, since they were getting first-hand information of the English itself, they were very much interested in this particular language. They frowned upon their own native culture, their own native, you know, texts, their own native literature. And they were fascinated by this particular new alien culture. So just as English was used for egalitarian purposes, you know, by historians, by, you know, advocates, administrators, the tehsildars, the magistrates and all. So similarly, even some creative writers also thought, why not use English for creative purposes? Yes, we have, you know, a district magistrate using English for ruling purposes. We have tehsildar coming to our villages, you know, writing down all the names, documenting all the, you know, loans and all taken in English. Why don't we use this language for creative output? Why don't we write in English? So definitely they started to write in English, but they imitated the Western models because this was the initial stages of Indian English writing. Now they were imitating whom? The models, the Western models. Okay, so they imitated the Western models. That is why, like, you know, other new literatures, Indian writing in English was also the product of cultural encounter, colonial and cultural encounter. That is why the first stage of all literature is the phase of copying, imitation. You copy, you imitate. That is all new literatures, frontier provinces of a native tradition, which was British literature. So British literature was copied, it was imitated, the writers were copied, and thus the literature began. Now, when this phase was an imitative phase. So we have, you know, Lord Byron was imitated, Sir Walter Scott was imitated, you know, Wordsworth was imitated, and we have a whole list of, you know, Western writers who were copied from. But how long can you go on imitating? there will come a time where you need to stop imitating and you need to leave your own imprint. You leave your own impression. Now, so the second phase was of introducing components of identity, history, culture, language. See, historical circumstances brought the colonizers. They created cultural condition, and that is why we have, you know, writers such as Nisim Ezekiel saying that historical circumstances creates cultural condition. So since English was introduced and it was used by all shades of people for, you know, purposes for ruling and all, so similarly, some creative writers also adopted English language, though it was not their mother tongue. It was not their L1. L1 is first language. See, for example, first language is the language that you acquire when you are a kid, when you are small. And L2 becomes the second language, which is learned formally. You know, at a particular stage, it is learned. So you see, these writers started to write in L2 and not in L1. Okay, so it was not their mother tongue. English was never their mother tongue. Though it was not their mother tongue, but still they wrote in it. They decided to write in second language, L2. There were many other cases where people, you know, even if you look globally, there are many writers who did not write in their L1, but started to write in L2. We have the famous case of Joseph Conrad. Conrad was not in English, but he wrote in English. We also have Samuel Beckett. Samuel Beckett has also written in French, even though he is not French. So now, you know, to say that we should not write in English simply because it is the, you know, the language of the colonizers. It is the language of the people who came and ruled us. It is, you know, kind of not in tune with the time. We cannot go back to pre-colonial time, and we cannot debunk the entire concept of writing in English and say that, you know, English should be negated. And we need to, you know, go back to the earlier, you know, new Tarzanism. That is, Tarzan must go back to the jungle. Now saying that we need to, you know, go back to the time of Tarzan is not possible. Tarzan cannot go back to the jungle now, can he? No, that is not possible, because Tarzan has already come to the city. He has seen the city life. He has also visited Pizza Hut. He has probably had a couple of burgers in KFC and a bucket also of nuggets. So it is not possible for Tarzan to go back to the jungle now. Similarly, it is not possible for us to go back to the pre-colonial time and say that we have nothing to do with English. You get my point? The point is, right now, you know, the time when the English was starting to be taken up by the Indian writers, I'm talking about the early, you know, the first trend, that is when writers were taking up English. So they started copying Sir Walter Scott because he was new to the arena. Now, what did they write? The early writers, they wrote about historical novels. The novels, you know, the first phase, therefore the first phase of Indian English novels were that of historical novels. Now, this is a very important trend because this laid the foundation of the coming trends which eventually followed. Because remember, it was the second half of 19th century and it was the heyday of British Raj, British imperialism. Indians, they rose against the British in 1857, which we called the First War of Independence. And the Britishers call it as mutiny. So, you know, the First War of Independence was, you know, announced, it was fought, and we failed. Indians were brutally killed, butchered. And then, you know, 1857 had a very strong impact on the minds of the Britishers. They, after 1857, adopted the policy of divide and rule. They created a kind of a discord between the Hindus and the Muslims. And it was, you know, after this revolt that the East India Company stopped its functioning and the control was, you know, transferred. The power was transferred to the Queen, Queen Victoria. Now she became the Empress of the Empire. Now British Empire had an empress, now Queen Victoria. So the Indians could not openly revolt against the British after 1857. It was very difficult for them because now it was under the control of the British Empire. More soldiers were sent in, the army was strengthened, and very stringent measures were taken, you know, against anybody who could, you know, kind of voice their displeasure, or kind of any uprising was crushed brutally. So what did the Indians do? They took a different, you know, tactics. They went for what is known as literary revolt. They romanticized their past. They said that we will revolt against the British Raj, but we will not revolt it via the sword. The creative writer said, now this revolt is going to be done by the pens. We will romanticize our past. We will talk about how, you know, good we were before the British came. That is how the historical novel suited them. Without the fear of being banned, they wrote historical novels. But remember, these historical novels are not of very high merit. So we have a couple of historical novels. For an example, we have Ram Krishna Pant's The Boy of Bengal, written way back in 1866. We have Tarachand Mukherjee's The Scorpions or the Eastern Thought, 1874. We have Lal Bihari Day's Govinda Samanta or the History of a Bengal Riayat, 1874. We have Sardar Joginder Singh's Noor Jahan, The Romance of an Indian Queen, 1909. Now, remember, this is not an exhaustive list. This is just a couple of examples, just to make you understand that how historical novels were suiting their purpose. What was the entire idea behind writing historical novels? The idea was simple: by romanticizing your past, kind of, you know, creating a situation in which people would take pride when they would understand, okay, this was my rich heritage before the Britishers came. But like I said, these historical novels were not of very high merit. That is why it is said that serious Indian fiction did not exist before 1920. So 1920, there comes a shift where we have socio-political novels. But remember, in historical, you know, in historical novels, what did we have? We have historical studies in the name of historical novels. Okay, we had, you know, but in the socio-political novels, we have sociological studies, novels in the form of sociological studies. So after 1920, serious Indian fiction comes into being. And this was the second trend that followed from historical novel. The second trend, like I said, the first was of imitation, where the simple, you know, Western models were copied, imitated, and that is how it began. Then it was all historical novels, writing about your past, romanticizing your past, your, you know, kind of a culture. Then comes the second trend, where we have society playing a very important role in this. The second trend was, like I said, socio-political novel. Socio-political. This was the longest trend, and it is still found, you know, in some novels written now and then, but that is, we'll talk about later. But you see, socio-political novel, that is social novel plus political novel. So from 1920 to 1960, the socio-political novel, there is a relationship between the novel and society, novel and people, social reality. Socio-political novel focus on external reality, the surroundings, okay? How things are around you. Now, this socio-political novels, you know, it examples we have, it started with long time back with the writings of K.S. Venkat Ramani, when he wrote the two famous work of his, Murugan the Tiller and Kandan the Patriot. In Murugan the Tiller, like I said, the themes will be of, you know, society, external reality will be shown. Society will become the focus, main focus point will be society. So what do you have in Venkat Ramani's, you know, Murugan the Tiller? It is a story of two young South Indian friends, Kedari and Ramu. It is the impact of Gandhian principles that can be seen on this character, on these characters. Remember, 1920, it started. So definitely it would have the entire, you know, notion and the concepts of freedom struggle. So 1920s, 30s and the early 40s was the time where Indians were going through a lot of difficult phases. We had the non-cooperation, we had the Quit India movement, we had the Khilafat movement, we had the civil disobedience movement, we had the Rowland Act, you know, the Dandi March, and we had, you know, Jallianwala Bagh cases. So the point is, these things. These, you know, notions are all represented during the second trend, socio-political novels. So in his second work, K.S. Venkatramani's Kandan the Patriot, now this particular novel, it is set against the background of civil disobedience. Remember, 1930, and this novel is about Kandan. He is an Oxford graduate, you know, freshly returned from the West, who has a good job in Indian civil services, but he resigns from his job in order to participate in the freedom struggle that was called by Gandhi. Now, we have Mulk Raj Anand's Untouchable. Now, we must have come across this, you know, a kind of a landmine. This, in fact, Mulk Raj Anand's Untouchable is supposed to be one of the most important novel of the second trend. Now, the evil of untouchability is the main theme in this novel. It draws our attention towards the miseries faced by the untouchables. The characters presented in Untouchable is, you know, it's very relatable. We can still find characters in our society nowadays facing the ill, you know, the ill manners of, you know, untouchability. Then we have his next novel, Coolie. The main theme of Coolie is the exploitation by the poor, exploitation of the poor by the rich in the early 20th century. We have the central character, Munu. Munu runs from pillar to post, but in the end, what he gets is only suffering. It is about the human suffering and what, you know, the entire concept of industrialization brings to this particular world. Then we have Mulk R.K. Narayan's Swami and Friends, Guide, Waiting for Mahatma. Guide, we are very much, you know, aware of the story. It was also adapted into a movie. Now, Guide is a story of Raju. It is a story of transformation of Raju from his role as a tour guide to that of a spiritual guide. So what happens? It is through the eyes of Raju. It is through the eyes of the protagonist that we get to know about what society was at that point of time. So what R.K. Narayan does, he surveys, he kind of, you know, shows us the entire society that was prevalent at that particular time. And in his next novel, Waiting for Mahatma in 1955, as the word suggests, as the title suggests, Waiting for Mahatma. In Waiting for Mahatma, Narayan uses the background of Indian freedom movement. The struggle is shown through the characters Shriram and Bharati. Now, Bharati is a typical Gandhian character. We'll talk about the advent of Gandhi also. Then we have Raja Rao, his novel Kantapura in 1838. The theme of this particular novel is the unification of different Indian castes. Remember, caste system was very, you know, stringent at that time till now. So the entire concept of this particular novel was that Raja Rao wanted to show the unification of different Indian castes under a Gandhian system of social justice during the fight against the British rule in India. His next novel, The Serpent and the Rope, has the theme of self-knowledge, self-fulfillment. Then we have Amir Ali's Conflict. Conflict is the agitation of 1942 movement, and it is shown through the eyes of the character Shankar. We have Abbas's Inqilab. It is a novel based on communal violence of 1920s and 30s. And we have Tomorrow Is Ours, Bhavani Bhattacharya's So Many Hungers. Now, this is a very important novel by Bhavani Bhattacharya in 1947. This is set against the background of Quit India movement and the Bengal famine of the early 40s. The novel deals with the theme of exploitation, political, economic, and social as well. Then his next novel in 1952, He Who Rides the Tiger, Bhavani Bhattacharya, finest novel, in fact. Many serious questions are posed through an absorbing narrative of this ironical reversal. It is a story of how a poor blacksmith, Kallu, vows to take revenge on society for jailing him on account of stealing a bunch of bananas. So that is what the story is all about, how a particular character is jailed because he wanted to, you know, quench the hunger by, you know, stealing a couple of bananas, and once out of prison, he vows to take revenge. Then we have Khushwant Singh's Train to Pakistan, 1956. The impact of partition is shown in this particular novel on a small village in the India-Pakistan border is shown through the eyes of the protagonist, who happens to be a ruffian, Jagga, okay, the Sikh village gangster and how, you know, he harbors love for this particular Muslim girl, and then what eventually happens. Then his next novel was there, I Shall Not Hear the Nightingale. Now it deals with the life of a Sikh family and their reaction to the freedom struggle. Then we have G.V. Desani's All About H. Hatta. It is a story of a hatter's spiritual quest for understanding the meaning of life. It has the East-West relationship is shown particular here. So you see, like I said, the list is not an exhaustive one. It is just to make the idea clear about what socio-political novels were all about, writing about society. So this continued till around 1960s. Then you see, after, you know, we have got the independence. Independence was achieved, and the five-year plans were also implemented. Problems of poverty was taken up, and to some extent solved also by the subsequent, you know, governments. Independence was already there. Country was also partitioned. You know, Bangladesh was also liberated. And then when the Indian stomach was full of all, you know, kind of problems, then there was no problem of poverty, no problem of hunger, and the other problems started to surface. That is, when we are hungry, when there are problems around us, then we do not think about other things. We do not think about our emotional needs. We do not think about our, you know, other problems, you know, problems of existentialism, physical problems. So when the outer problems are solved, internal problem starts to come up. That is, now Indian English novel shifted its focus from external reality, that is from society, to internal reality, that is within. So in 1963 came the shift. Now the self becomes the focus. Earlier, society becomes the focus, the outside becomes the focus, now the inside becomes the focus, self becomes the focus. So in 1963, this shift came. The trend of psychological come existential novels. Now there are two representative novelists of this phase. Now remember, the phase of social realism is finished, is over, rejected. So, you know, trend is, we need to understand this, trend is defined by dominance. So social realism can be still used even today. Even now, we can also have writers, you know, writing novels, you know, novels about like A Suitable Boy, which is all about 19th century India. But you see, these works are not representative novel of this age. Trend is defined by dominance. So, okay, so we may have little, you know, writers writing about historical novels today. We may have a writer writing about, you know, the socio-political novels today. But then that is not the trend, because the trend is always determined by the dominance. Okay, so the trend of social realism came to an end after 1960s, and internal realism started. Psychological realism started. Okay, self becomes important, and this was inaugurated by Anita Desai with the first novel in 1963, Cry the Peacock. Anita Desai and Arun Joshi. Now, they are the representative of this trend. We have the theme of alienation. Alienation is there. You know, Anita Desai is a woman novelist. Before Anita Desai, during the trend of socio-political novels also, we had the emergence of women novelists like, you know, Ruth Praveen Jhabwala, Nayantara Saigal. We also had Kamala Markandeya, yes. So you see, so these four novelists, as they are now known as, it is said that there was some element of feminism. But Anita Desai did not write as a feminist. Her focus is different altogether. In when we read this particular text, Cry the Peacock, we get to know that the theme of this particular novel is, you know, husband-wife alienation. It is temperamental incompetency. The character Maya and Gautam. It is about, you know, like the word itself suggests, Maya is worldly attraction. Gautam is, you know, detraction, cutting off, you know, renouncing the world. But okay, that is another point. But the point is, Anita Desai in this particular work shows alienation, husband-wife alienation, discord, feminism, it is a different thing that you can detect some elements of feminism and all here and there. But since woman novelist had surfaced, and in fact, serious Indian English novel, in fact, it began with a woman novelist, Toru Dutt. Like when I say serious Indian English fiction, it is known as something which can be noted. When she wrote Bianca, the Spanish Maiden, way back in 1878. So you see, there is a continuity between the early Indian woman novelist and today's woman novelist. We have a long tradition, but novel by Indian women were very sporadic here and there. Okay, so like, you know, we have writers like Zeenat Fateh Ali Zohra and, you know, Iqbal Unnisa's Parda and Polygamy. So, but they were not representative. After the emergence of these four, like I said, Kamala Markandeya, Roop Prabeja Hawal, Nayanthara Saigal, Anita Desai, you know, excuse me, you know, after the, you know, emergence of these four, and, you know, what was happening in and around the world was also very important. It also played a very pivotal role. Feminist movement were happening in America in 1968, you know, so all these movement played a very important role, and suddenly we have the trend of feminist or feminism in Indian English fiction after psychological novel. Now, in the 60s and 70s and the early 80s, we had a new creative bloom of women novelists who were not simply women, who were feminist, who were not simply women, they were feminist writers. Now see, there is a difference between women fiction and feminist fiction. They are two different things. And this phase was inaugurated by Shashi Deshpande. We have writers like Uma Vasudev, Arundhati Roy, Shobha De. Earlier, before 1960s, women novelists were very few. In fact, you could count them on your fingertips. But now we have a huge amount, a plethora of women novelists. The trend of feminism is still there. But after 1980s, with the publication of Salman Rushdie's Midnight Children in 1981, a new trend was introduced, that of postmodernism. So some important, you know, works in this particular, you know, trend of psychological come existential novels are Anita Desai, the one which we had talked about, Cry the Peacock. Now, in this particular novel, you know, husband-wife alienation is shown. It is a breakdown of communication between Maya and Gautam, the protagonists of this particular novel. Then we have the next work, Bye Bye Blackbird. Now, in this novel, exile and cultural alienation is the dominating theme of this novel. The characters, Dev, Sara, and Audit, becomes the victim of ontological insecurity. The next novel we have, Where Shall We Go This Summer, Fire on the Mountain, and etc. Then we have Arun Joshi's The Foreigner. Now, through this novel, Arun Joshi shows the quest for self. He deals with the theme of alienation and involvement. It shows the East and the West encounters. Then we have The Strange Case of Billy Biswas. This novel presents a protagonist alienated from the higher middle class society in which he was born and brought up and in which he is compelled to live. The next novel is Apprentice. Then we have Atiya Hussain's Sunlight on a Broken Column. This novel depicts the theme of decaying, fading away of a traditional family of Lucknow. This disintegration of the family takes place for various reasons, politics, different ideologies, communalisms, and all. Then we have Nayanthara Saigal's Storm in Chandigarh. This particular novel, it deals with the division of Punjab into two states when Punjab was divided into Punjab and Haryana. The protagonist is Vishal Dubey, a civil servant, and he has been sent to Chandigarh in order to take care and tackle the problems there. There he gets romantically involved with Saroj, who is already married. She's a woman and she's already married to Inder. And the kind of conflict, the internal conflict that happens in the mind of, you know, this main character, Vishal Dubey, is, you know, represented in this particular work. Then we have The Day in Shadow, and then Kamala Markandeya, A Handful of Rice. Now, Kamala Markandeya's A Handful of Rice, it is a very strong comment to awaken the society to the plight of the rural people, the rural India. We have the main character, Ravi. You know, he is caught in between the transition of tradition-bound rural society to the machine-ridden, materialistic and urban society. Then in the next novel, The Nowhere Man, Kamala Markandeya deals with the theme of alienation and loneliness, which comes out after East and West conflict. That is India and England conflict. Then we have also the, you know, Golden Honeycomb, and then Ruth Pravej Jhabwala's Heat and Dust and Search of Love and Beauty. So Search of Love and Beauty, it is about, you know, urban middle class Indian life, especially in undivided Hindu families and the ironic studies of East-West encounter. Now you see, these were the times when, you know, the psychological come existential, you know, novels were written, the themes were written. Now, themes change, techniques also change. That is why after 1980, remember the date is very important because it was the, you know, landmine, you know, text, Midnight Children. So after 1980s, we do not talk about the earlier trends and we talk about the new Indian English novel. Post-modernist novels, new Indian English novel. So before 1980s, that is before the publication of Salman Rushdie's Midnight Children, individual matter, like I said, you know, you talk about internal reality within. The focus is self. So individual mattered. But after 1980s, we have national allegories. People no longer wrote about themes of hunger and poverty. No novels on the struggle for independence. They wrote on national allegory. And individual did not matter anymore. There was a movement from individual to community. Remember, community. So this came, then came the trend of saga novels in postmodernism. We have a new complex themes. The theme of urban living, the dynamics of urban living, living in the city. The problems of, you know, the ruling class, the administration, like the novels of Upmanyu Chatterjee. He was an IAS officer turned a novelist. So we see after 1980s, we have the next trend, the trend of postmodernist writings. Postmodernism. Older themes and techniques were rejected. New themes, new techniques, and a new vision was introduced. And that is why some novels on earlier themes were written, but not exclusively. Midnight Children is a wonderful novel. Now, this particular novel is not exclusively about partition. There are so many issues in these novels. That is why I said national allegories are present. Another example is, you know, Shashi Tharoor's The Great Indian Novel. Techniques of parody, metafiction, magic realism, all are present here. We have, you know, Nayanthara Seibel's Yatra, okay, in which, you know, we have the color of the skin changes. In fact, Midnight Children itself, Salim Sinai has the power to read the mind of people, okay? That is how he does. So this is what? Magic realism. And we have even, you know, Mukul Keshwan looking through the glass, you know, in this particular, you know, text, we have the main protagonist. He can travel, he can time travel. So what is this? This is an example of magic realism. So this trend still continues. Now, this was all because of the impact of Midnight Children. So strong, so tremendous was the impact that now the older division of post-independence and pre-independence writings have been debunked, left away. Now we have writings after Rushdie and writings before Rushdie. So this is how the division is done. Rushdie's novel was so shattering that other novelists followed him and they came to be known as Midnight Children. Now remember, Midnight Children is also the name of a work by Salman Rushdie, and Midnight Children is also a critical term. Now when Midnight Children is, you know, in double inverted commas, it becomes a critical phrase, and it is used to describe the influence of Rushdie, you know, on writers. Many writers were under the influence of Rushdie and they wrote. We have writers like Shashi Tharoor, the great Indian novel. We have Alan Seely's The Trotelnama. Okay, so after 1980s, we use the term new Indian English novel because everything about it was new. Quit India movement was not their theme. Hunger and poverty was also not their theme. Conflict between tradition and modernity was not their theme. They are not writing about individual quest of identity. Now, the new Indian novel is about saga novel. It involves 3-4 generations, like Trotelnama, Alan Seely's Trotelnama, hero, the Hotel Everest. Okay, then we have the House of Blue Mangoes by David Davidar's. Okay, even The Glass Palace, Amitabh Ghosh, Upmanyu Chatterjee's English August, The Last Burden, Mukul Keshwan's Looking Through the Glass, 1995. So you see, the trend of social realism, which was started by Mulk Raj Anand. Remember, Mulk Raj Anand was the pioneer who started the entire concept of social realism. And remember, he was very much influenced by Gandhi. Like I said, Gandhi played a very important role in the growth of the second trend. There is a connection, a very strong connection between the rapid growth of Indian English novel in the 30s and the advent of Mahatma Gandhi's in the 20s. Mahatma Gandhi wrote Hind Swaraj. He's a post-colonial critic. He was in favor of many freedoms, not just one freedom. Gandhi had many, you know, agendas. He wanted freedom from the British political rule. He wanted freedom from poverty, freedom from superstition, freedom from caste, freedom from untouchability. So when K.S. Venkatramani, who anticipates the agenda, like I said, yes, when we have K.S. Venkatramani, who anticipates the agenda of social political novels in his two novels, Murugan the Tiller, 1927, and Kandan the Patriot, okay, in 1927. So what he shows us the problems of rural life and the problems of British Raj. Gandhi was the first person who openly articulated anti-colonial resistance. So naturally, Gandhi will definitely leave his impact on Indian English fictions, you know, in terms of his ideology, in terms of his popularity. So in some novels, he is present as a character. And in others, he is the invisible hero. His ideology is present as a satyagraha, as a social reformer. And since in India, the social, the political, and the religious are all interlinked. So in one novel, he is presented as an avatar, because we Indians believe in avatar, the concept of avatar, like in Kanthapura. And in Untouchable, Mulk Raj Anand's Untouchable, he calls Dalit the children of God, Harijan, the children of God. He gives them respectability. Gandhi considers untouchability as a social stigma. We also have a glimpse of Gandhi in this novel also. And, you know, in fact, this novel, Untouchable itself, was written in Gandhian impact. It was written, you know, under the impact of Gandhi. Mulk Raj Anand had actually lived in Sabarmati Ashram cleaning toilets. So in some novels, his ideology is probed, and his ideology of non-violence, as in A Bend in the Ganges by Manohar Malgaonkar. So Gandhi becomes a major prototypical character, and he's presented sometime as an astute politician, as in Waiting for Mahatma by R.K. Narayan, Waiting for Mahatma. And we have the character, like I said, Bharti, who is a Gandhian. We have other novelists also who used Gandhi's image and ideology, novelists like Gopal Mukherjee, Dhan Gopal Mukherjee, Venkat Ramani, Raja Rao, R.K. Narayan, Abbas, you know, Bhavani Bhattacharya. So this is what I said. So what initially, you know, started as the social political novels by Mulk Raj Anand now was coming to an end. The trend of social realism, which was initiated by Anand and which was continued by Kamala Markandeya, Bhavani Bhattacharya, and then Ruth Prabej Jhawala, is now over. Now we have parody, like the great Indian novel. The great Indian novel, Shashi Tharoor. We have fresh interpretation of older themes. The focus is the dynamics of urban living. So, like I said, we may still have works on society. We may still have some novels written in the historical sense, but these are not representatives of the trend. So like I said, trend is always determined by the dominance. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you, Swayb, for this enlightening lecture. Actually, you have encompassed quite a huge area of study in just less than 1 hour.
Probably.
That's a tremendous job, man, I must say.
I was a bit scared because of the connectivity. I had a lot of problems.
It was totally coherent. It was totally coherent.
It's raining a lot since yesterday night here. So
I understand that.
The Javed cyclone has at least have impacted us here. So right.
Anyway, it was very fluid in delivery. So I just listened through it without pausing. In between, I had to get up and go into other room, but then I shifted to my phone itself so that I don't miss any single word of this lecture.
Right.
Anyway, now this session is open for question answers. So students, you may have many doubts in it, so you can shoot them. Sir is here to answer you. So before anyone asks, let me discuss something with you. See, when we started adapting, am I audible?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. When we started writing novels in the beginning stage, novel was still in the nascent stage, I presume, in England itself. So is it simply we imitated them, or we just adapted them? Not adopting, but we just adapted them. What do you think?
Yes, absolutely. Like I said, the first stage of any writing is the imitation stage. That is, you adopt, then we adapt, and then we adapt. So the mm-hmm. first stage was simply seeing how the West writes poetry. How the by seeing how they write is the choice of words, the language, the diction, the style. I'm not talking about mm-hmm. the theme here. I'm not talking mm-hmm. about what they write. I'm talking about mm-hmm. how they wrote. So the language, that is why when we read a text, in fact, when we read Raja Ram Mohan's Wife, the particular text, it is very difficult because it has been modeled on the West. The style is modeled on the West. So like I said, they imitated the Western, writers. Sir Walter Scott was imitated, Wordsworth was imitated, and Shakespeare, they got very much fascinated by their works. So that is why the diction which they used, that was simply adopting. Then slowly, when we have the advent of the big three, we have changing this diction in order to, suit the Indian ethos. Because when you write about India, you need to write like Indians. So you cannot write about rural India using jargonistic words and philosophical words of the West. Right, absolutely.
Okay. Does anyone have any question? Okay, there is a message in the message box. Do you see it, Swayb, or shall I read it out? Swayb, your mic is off, I guess.
Yes, right. Sorry. Yes, Seema, once again, it was a wonderful question. Very relevant, in fact, that how it is failure of the author from Northeast to successfully offer a national acceptable novel. Yes, like I said, we may have writings by writers, sporadic writers writing here and there, but until and unless the themes are of dominance in nature, we have more people writing on it, it becomes a trend. For writing to become a trend, it has to have a small little canon formation. We may have writers writing about a particular, you know, a particular topic, a particular, you know, like I said, even today, we may have writer like Vikram Seth writing about a suitable boy. But till the time we have a more plethora of writers writing about the same trend, it doesn't become a trend. It will still become one off novel. So definitely you are right. So authors, you know, of periphery have got a central stage in recent times. Yes. So we need more people writing about a particular, you know, a topic, a particular kind of novel in order for it to become a trend. Right.
Okay. I have another doubt.
Yes.
Again, we have to discuss on it. See, when we read Dickens, he represented his contemporary societies, and which you said perhaps that will fall under this social, what was the term I forgot?
Social political novels.
And if we notice in Indian English writing, we lag behind by almost a century. Till Mulkar Sanan and all these three fellows, they started writing. That was almost a century.
Really?
So is it because that we are pretty much fascinated by this Western romanticism? We got entangled there, caught up there itself, and we thought of these social themes later on. That okay, we must write on these two as well. Was it one of the causes?
Yeah, it can be one of the causes. But in fact, you see, the second trend was where the Britishers actually, you know, held the entire country at that time. The first trend was Britishers were slowly and slowly getting a hold of India. And when the time they actually got the entire country under their dominance, that was the time when the social political novel started. 1857 was the, you know, time where we have the East India Company returning, and then we have the advent of the Queen Victoria in India. So it took another couple of 20, 40 years for the British Empire to spread its tentacles across the entire country. Now, once that was successful, the Indians started to come to this, you know, they came in terms with this fact that we are no longer a sovereign nation. And then started the trend of revolting in literary times. We do not take up swords. In fact, we take up pens, similar in lines of Charles Dickens. So yes, what Charles Dickens had done to the England, you know, Mulk Rajanand and R.K. Narayan had done to India. In fact, the poor 40s were there, and it was also done in India. But it was definitely a century later.
And when we imitate a particular canon or particular genre of writing, do you think there was one particular kind of conspiracy as well, that this kind of literature we glorify, Britishers did that as a result of which we imitated that kind, particular kind of genre?
Absolutely. Like I said, it is a marketing strategy. We will present to you something which is presentable so that you get fascinated. Like I said, surrogate Englishmen. What did they do? They took a couple of Indians to the West, showed them big buildings, marble, everything, probably a man with a hat, a coat, and a, you know, a stick walking, probably with a leather boots, smoking a cigar, and they showed this is the world. Now, when they came back to India, we have the same, you know, a Bengali, a Bhadra Lok being born in India, who has been to the West a couple of years. Once he comes back to India, he tries to speak in English.
Absolutely.
And he speaks in English even to a rickshaw puller, even to a slum dweller, and he forgets his identity. This is what is known as a marketing gimmick. You present your, you know, your thing in such a presentable way that the customer is forced to take it up, and he is forced to debunk his own identity and live in a different notion altogether. Right.
There might be another question from Ankita Chetri.
Yes. Yes. We have a question by Nupur also. Thank you, sir, for the words. I do have a question as well. Novels should have readers, right? How far should we depend on a publisher to make something popular or trending? Chetan Bhagat became popular, of course, but it is due only to his merit or due to the merit of publisher as well. See, publisher definitely have a role to play because they organize, you know, these, you know, book storming sessions and all. But until and unless the book has a merit, it will not run. So, like I said, Chetan Bhagat is a popular writer. Pulp Fiction is a very popular writer. But his popularity is not only to be credited to the publisher, but also to the work which he's written. Now, the reason why he is popular can also be traced to the fact that we also have many adaptations of his works in the popular cinemas also. Right, Ankita, thank you, sir, for providing us. When we say Indian English novels, do we emphasize on language more than it needs? Because merit-wise, there are many novels in Indian languages which might be a greater than celebrated novels. Yes, absolutely, Ankita. Yes, a very relevant point. Now, when we talk about Indian English novels, we primarily talk about novels written in English. Okay. Now, earlier, there was a notion about why translations cannot be included. Because translation is predominantly written in the vernacular languages and it is translated into English. So we never included those texts which have been translated until it was translated by the said writer himself. For example, Tagore. Tagore's Gitanjali comes in the canon of Indian English writings because Tagore himself had translated. But his other works, which was translated by others, fall under translation studies. So yes, definitely, your question is relevant. Other text is not to be, you know, they are not in contrast to one another. Indian English novels is not in contrast with Assamese novels or Bengali novels or Tamil novels. They are equally of high merit. In fact, if not less, definitely more merit. But the point here is about Indian English novels. Novels predominantly written in English by writers earlier belonging to India, but how somewhere connected to India itself. Right.
There are two more questions, but before that,
yes.
Since we are talking about this adopt, adapt and adapt, that brings to one point. Shall we discuss this growth of Indian English novel? Can we relate it or make this study, bring this study under these post-colonial theories?
Yes, we can do that.
Post-colonial theory also deals with this.
Absolutely. Theory. Absolutely. Absolutely. Like I said, Indian English writing is a cultural product of post-colonialism itself. Because post-colonialism, the entire concept of Indian English writing, the entire concept of this particular, you know, phenomenon of Indian English is the cultural, you know, contact between the East and West encounter. Absolutely.
Don't you think when we study the history of the growth of Indian English novels, don't we ignore this as a tool of post-colonialism?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Very relevant. We absolutely ignore this because for us, Indian English literature should come, in fact, if not, you know, at par, but at least in and around colonialism. We do not talk about colonialism. When we talk about Indian writing in English, just a couple of mention, Macaulay's Minutes, English being introduced, Presidency College, Hindu College being set up, Bhadralok being taken up and studying English, and that is it. But like I said, you know, correctly pointed out by you also, that colonialism was the root cause why we have English in our particular country. Now, like I said, something good and something bad happens. Macaulay's Minutes, for good or for bad, had introduced English to us. And here we are discussing English, using English against English itself. Right.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay, there is a question from Anas Rehman.
Anas, yes. I have a question regarding this topic. My question, why common middle class Indians developed an interest in English stories? Your question is probably why middle class developed interest in English. That should be the question. And it is a relevant question.
Before story, the language is...
Yes. Probably this is what he wanted to refer, why the middle class got fascinated. Yes, the middle class will get fascinated. Because the middle class was the only class which had to take up the jobs of zamindaris. Say, for example, we have, you know, the zamindars who used to take up their profession from their, you know, fathers of zamindari. Now a new profession was in front of them: the profession of tehsildars, the profession of magistrates, the profession of being the administrators and how could they, you know, get into the shoes of this? By getting through the language. So these were the people, the middle class were the people that got fascinated, and they were provided the opportunity. They seized with both hands, went abroad, took up the English language, went into administration, and did the entire donkey work, which the Britishers found very difficult to do. That is why they introduced this language, in order for the Indians to do their work. Like I said, Britishers found it very difficult speaking in Tamil, Telugu, Kannad, Urdu, Hindi, Assamese, Bengalis. They had lots of difficulties. So they wanted one language, and they wanted the Indians to learn their language. Not all Indians, mind you, because if something becomes common, it loses its essence. They wanted some people, like I said, surrogate Englishmen. They wanted to create brown sahibs, color brown, Indian. But at the same time, taste would be English. They wanted to create brown sahibs who would be fascinated by the culture, by the language. But in fact, they would be doing their work of administration. The helm, at the helm would be a white English sahib. But beneath him would be numerous brown sahibs working, toiling day and night for them. Right.
So, what do you
think? Yes, yes.
Before going to that, again, I am interrupting. when we talked about that lagging behind in terms of the social themes, but after globalization, when kick started, then we see that we immediately caught up with the global trend of novel writing. Don't you think that?
Absolutely. That is the reason why.
Is it because that globalization gave us a better exposure all of a sudden?
Very much, very much. Exposure teaches a lot. That is why Indians are winning the Booker Prize, the Man of Booker Prize,
exactly.
The Pulitzer Prize. Absolutely, absolutely. Very true. Very true. We are beating them at their own game. And this is the product of globalization. Absolutely.
So when discussing, we should consider this aspect as well.
Absolutely. That, like after I said, colonization,
after colonization, perhaps this is another paradigm shift in terms of themes.
Yes.
Globalization had an impact on English writing, novel writing.
Absolutely. Now the center itself is being, you know, decentered, and the margins is coming to the center. Right.
Yeah. Everything is converging to one point.
Absolutely.
Okay, Anandya Borua, she has a question.
Yes. Why do you think Indian English novels use simply language, whereas other novels are a little tougher to understand? Why do you think Indian English novels use simple language, whereas other novels are a little tougher to understand? Your question is not...
Perhaps means that we Indian English novelists, they write in a more easy language than the typical, within quote, English writers.
No. That could have been a possibility. That could have been a possibility if you're talking about the, you know, the social political trend. Try reading Shashi Tharoor's novel. Then you'll understand. Then you'll understand the simple language which he uses. Absolutely. Like I said, the present trend, the postmodernist trend, is nowhere less than what a British English is all about, or what an American English is all about. Absolutely.
Actually, why we find Indian English novels easier to read is that because of the social structure, we can understand better.
Absolutely.
Than an English social structure or any other country's social structure. We are more acquainted with all these structures. So that's why we find it very easy,
very easy
to understand.
We can relate to it. Absolutely.
We can relate to it. Whatever is being depicted, we can imagine that. Okay, this is like the street right in front of my house. Like that, we can imagine the situation. You can visualize.
Absolutely. Try reading Malgudi Days. Malgudi is nowhere, but it is everywhere.
Nowhere, yeah.
It is everywhere. So these are relatable things. That is why it becomes easy.
Do you think, one more thing. This is perhaps the last question from my side. when you think about these paradigm shifts in Indian English writings, writings as a whole, not only novels, do they concentrate more on the contemporary themes rather than universal themes? Do the writers, Indian English writers, they concentrate more on the contemporary themes and contemporary values, social values, rather than writing about the past? Even if someone writes about the past today, that will be under the light of the present social values.
Absolutely, yes, yes, yes. They are more, yes, like I said, the postmodernist trend is writing about the community today itself. Okay, they like I said, I gave an example of, you know, Midnight Children. Now, Midnight Children definitely has the entire concept of saline cyanide, talking about partition, emergency. We talk about history, but here history is not in isolation. You know, partition is not in isolation. It is in relation to the present society, the present times, in tunes with the socioeconomic conditions. So yes, definitely, it, even if it is writing about now, it is about the current times, the current, you know, themes that are prevalent. Yes.
Does anyone have any more questions? Okay, Akashuri Sharma, he has raised his hand.
Yes.
And sir, I have posted one question.
Okay, yes.
No question, one second. Yes, when we attempt to formulate a genre of writing, such as Indian writing in English, per se, it is cultural formulation or linguistic. Okay. In case of Indian, if in case of English writers from Northeast, it appears to be more spatial. Right? True. These writers are mostly defined by the location within post-1947 political boundaries of Indian state. Well, like I said, nothing is apolitical. Even, you know, writings, novels, stories, they definitely have the elements of politics involved in it. But writers, I don't think, my personal point of opinion would not be that since, you know, writers are defined by the spatial, you know, the boundaries separating or the place which they come from or they write, they are classified in that way. My personal opinion would not be in it. But yes, definitely, politics does, you know, favor. We have writers and we know writers whose books are yet to be, you know, published in India, writers whose book are yet to be, you know, kind of seen in the book shelves in India. But yes, politics definitely has a role, but writers being, you know, favored because of their boundaries is not something that I would, you know, very much agree on, Akash. Yes.
Any more queries?
Yes, thank you, Akash.
Anyone else want to say something? Apart from only thanking him, you may have many more queries, so you can shoot it.
Right, I'm saved.
We started with 70 participants and now it shows only 50. So some people have already got their doubts cleared.
Yes, cleared. Probably a Sunday evening is catching up.
Sunday evening, tomorrow they have a sessional exam.
Right. Yes, you mentioned. Right. So let's not hold them back anymore if there aren't any questions.
Yes, okay. How would you interpret the terminology notice writers?
How would you define the terminologies? Northeast writers. Yes, classification according to their boundaries. Yes, absolutely. Northeast writers. Now these classifications should not be there in the first cell, you know, sense itself. Classifications are enough with novels and poetries and dramas, and not Northeast writers or South Indian writers. Classification should not be there, but yes, it's a very...
But in terms of geopolitical and sociopolitical, all these factors, we may consider such categories, right?
Yes, yes. Like I said, categories
because
do
no
exist.
No one from Delhi would write about an inner socio-political conflict of Nagaland.
Absolutely. That is what I said. Politics definitely has to play. Some people turn a blind eye, but then that is the harsh truth of, you know, writings also. Until unless you write about your identity, people would never accept your identity.
Mm-hmm. One thank you from Paityasi Bordului, and many more may be coming.
Thank you.
So, people, do you have anything to ask? Anything more? Afsana Sehta is again thinking only, no question.
I guess the questions are over now.
Yeah. They'll think only when they will appear in the exam. Then only they might think that I should have asked this question to sir.
Probably. No, but then Santolan sir will definitely take care of the rest.
No, I won't be able to take care of this much seriously. Perhaps now we should proceed to vote of thanks, which will be offered by our head of the department, Dr. Divyajyoti Bora. Divyota, are you there?
Yes. Thank you, Santolan. Honorable principal of our college, Dr. Dipakon Borua, our most valued invited speaker, Dr. Swai Vikram, my dear colleagues present here and my dear participants, it is my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion. I, on behalf of the Department of English, offer my gratitude to Dr. Swai Vikram of Rabindra Bharati University, Kolkata, for his deeply thought-provoking and insightful lecture on the rise of Indian English novel. Thank you, sir, for illuminating us with your profound knowledge on the subject. I'd also like to thank our principal, Dr. Dipakon Borua, for offering all possible help to organize this program. A big thanks to our students who participated in the lecture and actively interacted with the resource person. With this, I conclude my vote of thanks. Thank you. Over to Dr. Santolan Mohanto, the moderator of the program.
So, Swayb, this brings us to the end of this session. And we hope that we'll get you again in some future lectures. This season continue, and from time to time, I will bother you with such requests. Definitely hope that you won't disappoint us.
Are never. You've been a very wonderful senior for me. Our friendship goes almost a decade back. Yes, definitely.
Yeah, it is more than a decade.
Yes.
Right from 2008. And I just remembered that since 2015, right? It has been 6 years we haven't met.
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
And today we are talking on the screen.
This is what life is all about.
everything is digital and everything
Absolutely.
Is virtual, yet it gives a pleasure to meet again.
Yes. Thanks I'm really Google. Very happy to see you. Very, very happy to see you.